Good evening and welcome to Crown of Life, to everyone joining us online and to our members who are braving the opening up and joining us in person today. It's nice to be back in our facility. Just a few announcements before we begin. If you haven't started using it yet, we'd encourage you to connect with us using the YouVersion Bible app. With it, you're able to carry God's word with you, and you also have access to the sermon notes as well. Growth groups will be starting up this week and are going to follow the sermon series that we are just starting. So we're going to have questions and answers that focus on God's gift of government, something that is very timely at the moment for us. We are also starting our every member visits in October and November. So please expect a call or connection with your pastor, your campus pastor, to set a time up. It's just a wonderful opportunity for us to touch base and to connect and to keep that connection with each other nice and healthy. Also, starting this week and continuing over the next set of weeks until mid-November, we have our Samaritan's Purse. And this is a program where we connect with our community and provide a gift for individuals and young children in need. And it gives us an opportunity to connect and to also provide a gift that will also proclaim the gospel. And that is something that goes way beyond the borders of our community overseas. So we'd encourage you to join us in that program, and then all our campuses in mid-November will collect the boxes and we'll drop them off and as we support this program. Also, the campout is coming up on November 6th through 8th in Idlewild. Registration form will go out quite shortly. We'd ask you to please click on it and to sign up. It's going to be an opportunity for us, while following social distancing guidelines, to have some fellowship time together. I just learned that it's been over 6 months since COVID began, 180 days, and so to have an opportunity to spend time together is just absolutely fantastic. We will begin our service with our Grace, mercy, and peace are yours in abundance. From God our Heavenly Father, through our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. The words God speaks to us this evening that touch not only the topic of discussion, God's gift of government, but it really impacts every aspect of our lives. Those words are found in Romans chapter 13, which say, "Let everyone be subject to the governing authorities, for there is no authority except that which God has established. The authorities that exist have been established by God. Therefore, whoever rebels against the authority is rebelling against God and what God has instituted. And those who do so will bring judgment on themselves. For rulers hold no terror for those who do right, but for those who do wrong. Do you want to be free from someone in authority? Then do what is right and you will be commended. For the one in authority is God's servant for your good. But if you do wrong, be afraid. For the rulers don't bear the sword for no reason. They are God's servant, his agents of wrath, to bring punishment on the wrongdoers. Therefore, it is necessary to submit to the authorities, not only because of possible punishment, but also because of a matter of conscience. That is why you are to pay taxes. For the authorities are God's servants who give their full time to governing. Give everyone what you owe them. If you owe taxes, pay taxes. If revenue, revenue. If respect, respect. If honor, honor." This is the word of the Lord. Friends and family of Faven, who will be confirmed this evening, let's begin with a riddle, right? What is something that is with you from the moment you are born? It grows and it shrinks. It breaks. It's responsible for so much of the happiness you have in your life. And it's with you throughout your whole life. What is it? Sounds pretty important, doesn't it? And now, I'm not going to put you on the spot, David. But we're talking about relationships. What type of relationship do you have with God's gift of government? See, relationships are with you your whole life. From the moment you are born, they grow, and sometimes along the way they shrink. They are responsible for so much of your happiness, and they're with you. And yet, you know what happens if you try to put too much energy into a relationship, or not enough. If you put too much energy into a relationship, somebody might say you are a little clingy, and they may kind of try to create some space. If you say that someone isn't putting any effort into a relationship, they might say you're unloving. And so relationships have a very fine balance between showing love and showing a lack of hatred. And yet, relationships are all around you. You have a relationship as a child, a parent, a spouse, a friend, a neighbor. You also have a relationship as a citizen of the country you're in. And it's that relationship with the country that you live in we're going to spend the next few weeks talking about. So friends, what kind of relationship do you have with God's gift of government? Is it solid? Is it salty? Is it shaky? To answer that question, I'm going to ask you another question. When you think of the time we're in, as we move towards another election, as we've watched the debates and we're looking at the Facebook feeds and the news articles, is it something you look at and say, "I'm not interested in this at all and I'm just waiting for it to be over"? Or is it something that keeps you up at night, that you think about it, and those thoughts pass your mind, well, if the wrong person gets in or the wrong people, then God's gift of government is going to implode, and it's going to be the end. What kind of relationship do you have? That's something we're going to talk about over the next few weeks. We're going to talk about these relationships. And yet, these relationships are nothing new. They even, as from a child through entering adulthood, you have been connected to your Lord. You have your relationship there. You've been connected to your parents, who God has set above you to raise you in the training and instruction of the Lord. And that's why you're here tonight. You have a relationship with your government, with your school, with your friends, with your family, as all of us do. And yet this is nothing new. For the Romans, those Roman Christians who first read these words, they had what we would most probably call they were the victims in an abusive relationship between the government and themselves. The government that they were serving under found very unique and creative ways to arrest and imprison and execute Christians. They found very unique ways of oppressing Christians. And so what was God's encouragement to them as they looked at all their relationships? What's God's encouragement to you as you think about all the relationships you have, including that relationship with God's gift of government? That's really what we're going to look at this evening. And to begin, we're going to see that as God speaks to us about his gift of government, he asks us to roll with it. And yes, that is spelled correctly. He wants us to look at the purpose and the function that government has in our lives as we look at what a healthy relationship looks like. And so I'm just going to read a few verses from Romans chapter 13. In the first two verses we read, "Let everyone be subject to the governing authorities, for there is no authority except which God has established. The authorities that exist have been established by God. Consequently, whoever rebels against the authority is rebelling against what God has instituted, and those who do so will bring judgment on themselves." Friends, what stands out the most in this verse? Is it the fact that we learn that every office in government and every person in government is handpicked by God to serve in that role? Or is it the fact that God says if we disobey the people he has picked, that there is judgment that results? That if we disobey the people that God has picked, it's like we're disobeying God and fighting against him? So what does a healthy relationship look like with God's gift of government? To answer that, we need to read on a little bit more. See, God tells us, "For the one in authority is God's servant for your good. But if you do wrong, be afraid, because they don't bear the sword for no reason. They are God's servants of wrath to bring punishment on the wrongdoer." And here God makes a distinction between his two kingdoms. The kingdom of the gospel, the kingdom of the church, which uses the gospel to change hearts and minds and actions. And God also introduces another kingdom, a more distant kingdom that he has authority over, the kingdom of the earth, including God's gift of government. And what weapon does God give them? The sword. Remember, a sword isn't there to just kind of warn someone. It's a weapon that can be quite lethal. And so God uses that law that governments have to change actions, to change outward actions. And yet, in that sentence, it says, "But these are God's servants that are there for your good." And yet, is there a part of you right now that is sitting down and thinking, "But I just don't like the people God has placed over me. I don't feel a connection. I I see what they maybe stand for. And so there's a part in our mind that kind of stamps up and down and says, I just don't feel like it. But you notice in Romans chapter 13, God doesn't ask us how we feel. Just as God placed a government over the Christians in Rome that would ultimately outlaw being a Christian, that would ultimately bring the death penalty for worshiping Jesus, just as God encouraged those Christians to submit to the authority he had set over them, in the same way he tells us, I want you to submit to the officers and the government I've placed over you. And yet what happens? Oh, we rage, don't we? We rage and we find fault. And God comes to us and he says, my child, focus on my kingdom, the kingdom of the church. But then why does God oversee the kingdom of the earth, the kingdom, his gift of government? It's there to bring good. It's there to bring peace and security. And here it is again. It says, for rulers hold no terror over those who do what is right, but for those who do wrong. Do you want to be free from the one in authority? Then do what is right and you'll be commended. And there it is. The government has rules. Now, if you've ever been pulled over for violating a traffic law, you've seen the patriotic lights. You've had the experience of the officer coming up to the car as your heart races, and have the first words out of your mouth ever been, thank you, officer, for being God's agent of wrath and for pulling me over? That's usually not a very wise thing to say, or the first word out of our mouth. But that's what they are serving. They are one of the most visible forms of God's gift of government that are there to protect us. And sometimes that protection includes paying a fine and going to driving school. And yet God says, I'm creating the structure and order so that I can protect you. And we look at the laws in our land. We look at the freedoms we have to gather here this evening, to gather online electronically, to worship Jesus openly. What a wonderful privilege. And so God gives us his gift of government for peace and security, and he encourages us, make sure we obey all the laws that they give us. Now, there is an exclusion clause in there. We will talk about it a bit later, where God says, you know, if the government tells you to do something contrary to my word, then it's important to follow God rather than man. But that says if the government tells you personally to do that, then there's the exclusion clause. And yet, friends, do you find yourself raging against what God has established? Do you find yourself watching the TV or following the Facebook feeds and you throw your hands up and you say, ah! And yet our God comes to us and he says, my children, I love you. This is a gift. And it's a gift I want to give you as you willingly submit to my gift of government for the sake of Jesus. And we rage. And yet we don't have to go far to see that this is nothing new. We go to Psalm 2, and it starts out with the section of God saying, oh, the kings of the earth all rally against me, and they throw off their chains, and they shake their fists and say, we don't want to follow you, God Almighty. And do you know what God's response is? He laughs. He laughs from his throne in heaven, and he says, oh, kiss the Son lest he be angry. And then it ends with this wonderful gospel promise saying, blessed are those who take refuge in God, and oh, we rage. So what is the danger, though, for you if you rage against God's gift of government? Well, God tells us that there's the sword, so we could get a fine. Like if you have a police officer chasing you and you say, I'm done. I'm not going to follow God's gift of government. That's not wise. You will make the 6 o'clock news, and oftentimes there is punishment that will follow. Some time in a detention center. And yet what happens if your resistance to God's gift of government is maybe not as overt? You're not speeding down the highway at 90 miles an hour with everyone chasing you. What happens if it takes the form of online comments or discussions where you rage against this gift God has given for your protection and safety? What happens if in doing so we find ourselves just rejecting what God has done? The danger is here, and it's this, that in doing so, we end up sinning against God. And every sin has one purpose. It's there to destroy our relationship with our God and our Savior. And friends, and Thavin, as you live under God's gift of government, as you serve under your parents who have been given the tough responsibility to raise you in the training and instruction of the Lord, and as God has given us all that responsibility to encourage one another even more as we see the day approaching, we need look no further than our Savior and our Lord Jesus, who willingly submitted to a government, a corrupt government, that falsely arrested him, that excelled in torturing him, and that illegally executed him. Why? Because the governor didn't want to deal with the fallout if people were upset with him? And yet, you see your God's love for you in this, that Jesus willingly submitted to the government, even though he knew what was going to happen. He willingly submitted perfectly. And we learn, like, as a sheep before its shearers is silent, so your Savior stood before that government silent, as he was falsely accused, wrongfully convicted, beaten, and then nailed to an instrument of death that he turned into an instrument of life. As your God and Savior hung on the cross, he perfectly obeyed his gift of government for you, so that you now have the perfect, restored relationship with your God, and that is by far the most important relationship you will ever, ever have. First and foremostly, Thavin, you are a child of God. Secondly, you will fulfill the other roles that God asks you to roll with it. As a student, one day as a husband, as an employee, and in all these things, with having the right relationship with your God, all these other roles will fall into place. So that is God's encouragement for you, and it's in God's encouragement for every single one of us. God says, just roll with it. And you know what happens when we roll with it? We get to use God's gift of government in a very God-pleasing way. We even get to dial 911 when the time is right and help is on the way. And so God speaks to us about his gift of government. And here it is. God tells us that, therefore, because God has established government, because God uses it for our protection, God says it's necessary to submit. And remember that word submit, we've looked at it quite a lot recently in previous sermons, and it's willingly placing ourselves under the authority of someone else for the sake of Jesus. That's what the definition is. And so as we submit to the authorities, not only because of possible punishment, but because it's a matter of conscience, this is why you pay taxes. For the authorities are God's servants who give their full time to governing. Give everyone what they owe them. If you owe taxes, pay taxes. If you owe revenue, revenue, respect, respect. If you owe honor, then give them honor. God's gift of government is right there to encourage and to protect you. And all God asks in your relationship with the people, with the parents, with the gift of government that he gives and he sets over you, is that you serve faithfully, that you serve fully as though you were serving the Lord. And that's it, isn't it? That's how we establish a healthy relationship with God's gift of government. We see it for what it is. We don't love it too much so that it becomes a savior and tries to replace Jesus. And we don't love it to the point of hating it. And so there's a healthy middle road there that God encourages us, because everything flows over. And isn't it amazing that in God's gift of government, as with God's gift of his kingdom of the church, that God takes this divine authority that he has and he starts breaking it up. He splits it and he says, this is for the government, this is for the church, this is for parents, this is for spouses, this is for children, this is for people who are working, this is for people who are studying and who will work. And God takes his authority and he just breaks it up, and it's like a water fountain. It just trickles down and it trickles down and it trickles down. And that's why our God says to us, my children, I'm doing this because I love you and I'm a God of order. And yet, do you notice a difference in the role of government and in the role of the church? In the role of government, God uses laws that say, change your outward behavior or else. How long does that change behavior? If I draw a line and say, don't step over the line, and then I leave for a while, how long will that law last? Most probably not very long. And yet, so we learn that God, in God's gift of government, laws that are aimed at changing our outward behavior don't have a long-lasting impact. So what does? How do you change someone's behavior so that it's permanent? See, this is a gift God only gives to his kingdom in the church. It's the gospel that changes hearts and minds and actions, and so God's word works from the inside out. It's where you see the love of your God for you, where you are covered in the forgiveness of sins for those things that haunt you, in which your God comes and he says, this is how much I love you. This is who you are, and that's your true identity. And it's in that truth and reality then we can act. Because if you look at the number of laws that exist in the state of California and in the United States, they are growing. The chart looks like an exponential curve. And so it's almost impossible to go down the street and keep every single law. There's even a law in Riverside that says you can't take carry your lunch down the main street from 11 to 1 p.m. I've taken my lunch down the street from 11 to 1. And yet those laws that are there to change outward action, just like God's gift of government, are temporary. Peace and security come and go, but your God points you. He points you back to his promises in his word, and he says, this is a gift that lasts forever, the gift of my church that uses the gospel to change hearts and minds. And that's where your God meets you. So here's the question then. What does a healthy relationship with government look like? Because it includes willingly submitting to government for the sake of Jesus. So as we enter the kind of the home stretch of the, I guess we call it an election season, there are so many big things happening. How can we develop a healthy relationship that doesn't leave us despising God's gifts, but that also doesn't leave us obsessing and seeing it as a savior, which it isn't? To help answer that question, I want to take you back to a gentleman in the Old Testament of the Bible by the name of Daniel. Daniel and his people had been exiled. After disobeying God, God had sent a foreign nation to attack his people, and they had carried people off in the most destructive of ways. And so Daniel finds himself in this foreign nation serving a foreign government, and he is at the top. God had blessed him and many of his fellow Israelite co-workers. And he finds himself at the top of government, enforcing laws and following and submitting to God's gift of government under the king, until those people underneath him became a little jealous. And they said, King, why don't you make a law that says for the next 30 days, everyone's going to bow down and worship you as a god. And anyone who doesn't do that, they'll be executed. And so we know Daniel most likely from the lesson where he ends up in the lion's den. But what leads to the lion's den is that story where those people underneath him try to trap him, and they go to the king and say, Daniel has broken your law. And Daniel doesn't worship you as a god. And there you see the balance between having a healthy relationship with God and having a healthy relationship with the church. Daniel ends up in the lion's den and he tells the king, my God will save me one way or the other. And God finds a very unique way of saving Daniel where he binds the mouths of those lions, those ravenously hungry lions, so that when the king who doesn't sleep the whole night wakes up as soon as the sun peaks and he runs and he says, Daniel, has the Lord your God saved you? And Daniel says, the Lord my God has saved me. We see the balance of a healthy relationship that where Daniel sees himself as a child of God first and foremostly, and then he willingly submitted to God's gift of government to the point where it asked him to break his relationship with his God. And we see after this that Daniel's restored. The people who falsely trapped him are fed to the lions, and we're told that their bodies don't even reach the ground until the lions attack them and overpower them. So they were hungry. And yet we see that he continues to serve in God's gift of government as a wise ruler. And that's really where it is, isn't it? We get to see God's servants, his children, serving his gift of government, being lights in a very dark world by placing themselves willingly under those authorities and by serving for the sake of Jesus. And that's in God's encouragement for you. And so that's where the healthy relationship with God's gift of government lies. Over the next few weeks, we're going to see what happens when kind of the middle road in that relationship is pushed to the limits. We're going to see what happens when God's gift of government becomes an idol. We're going to see what happens when God's gift of government is despised. And then we're going to continue to focus on that healthy relationship as God encourages us to look after and to pray for those people in authority and in leadership positions. God grant you wisdom and his spirit in rich abundance during this time as you serve your Savior by willingly submitting to his gift of government. And the peace of God that far surpasses all understanding will guard and keep your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus.
Darkness tries to roll over my bones. When sorrow comes to steal the joy I own. When brokenness and pain is all I know. Oh, I won't be shaken. No, I won't be shaken. My faith.